how much does it play in your life, in your kids' life?
I think the privilege not many parents have, which is to be able to tell the kids, like, stop using daddy's app at 8 p.m. You know, I also have the privilege of telling them, don't download TikTok, just keep using YouTube.
What is the longest video ever on YouTube? Do you know this one?
Oh, what is this? When I was still there, we had a limit of 30 minutes. I'm sure it's gonna be much longer than that.
Well, it used to be a limit of 30 minutes.
Because I had to pay for the storage for how much the videos we were taking in.
Welcome to today's Taipei Tonight Show. I'm your host, Dennis Nieying. Thank you so much for watching us, coming straight to you from Taipei 101 building in Taipei City. This has been a very exciting couple of months for us in Taiwan. A lot of sports events happening here. Baseball is a big national sport here. And then the tournament that just happened, teams from all around the world was in Taiwan. So we went through this whole baseball craze. You guys into baseball at all?
Oh, yeah.
You guys were, right?
Well, I live in Temu, and so we have the...
Oh, the stadium.
Yeah, right,
it was right
here.
Yes, so it was a lot of excitement. Traffic must have been terrible.
It's always terrible there.
Oh, jeez, yes. Yeah. But so people in Taiwan, we love baseball. And it was, everybody was involved. Anywhere you go, the TV was on, people were watching the game. And businesses try to capitalize on it, try to be a part of it. So I understand that Pizza Hut, in high spirit, came out with a baseball-themed pizza. So on that pizza, they made a baseball out of a bawan and put it right in the center. And I'm not sure if they made the bases too. So it was a bawan. A bawan is kind of like a meatball pizza. So they made a meat baseball on that pizza. Right? But Taiwan's Pizza Hut, we're not strangers to surprising creative things. We had the ramen noodle pizza.
Have yes, you
had
yes, that? Yes. That was great. That was really nice, yeah.
I was wondering who was ordering that. So
that was me.
You ordered
that. I'm the one person that ordered it.
So Taiwan did have the ramen noodle pizza before. Another thing that caught me by surprise, whether they have, they had the pig blood cilantro.
Yes.
Pete's, you heard of this?
I got it.
You
that was Derek.
It.
That was Derek, yes.
You ordered, yeah, so people do order these things, but see, look at his face. The pig blood cilantro pizza. These are not jokes. These are real things that you can walk into a Pizza Hut and order in Taiwan right now if you are here. I mean, somebody need to tell these guys, you know, everything, everywhere, all at once is not a pizza recipe, all right? All right, but besides being brave in the culinary part, Taiwan is ranked number 4 as the safest city to live, again, in the world. This is one of the most friendliest and safe place. They have kids running around outside, the MRT, the public transportation is great. Number 4, safest city in the world for people to live, but ranked last for baboons to live in the world. Right. Well, we need to give the audience a little context, right? So there was a baboon on the loose. You guys knew about this because it was all over the news. It was a national event trying to find a loose baboon on the island. So if you're a baboon, don't run around in Taiwan. All right, there we go. Today we have a great show coming your way. We have a very, very special guest. He's a good friend of mine. He immigrated to the States when he was 15, co-founded an amazing company called YouTube, and later on was sold off to Google, and he is living in Taiwan now. Today he is here talking to us. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Mr. Steve Chen. Finally, we got you on the show. Man, it's such a pleasure to have you here. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for the invite. It's good to be here. moving back to Taiwan just a few years ago, it's a very different world from what we were used to living in Silicon Valley for 20 years. And so this is yet another new opportunity that that I'm seeing in Taiwan. So thank you.
Yeah, but this is really neat. All right, so a little bit about the story behind you sitting here today. You were a young immigrant. You moved to the States when you were 8. Same with me.
Okay.
We were about the same time. And then you grew up. Did you grow up in the Bay Area? Where did you grow up when you
I grew up in the Midwest, so in the northwest suburbs of Chicago there, which it's very different from the East Coast and the West Coast.
Yeah.
I think if you really want to get the experience of what living in the U.S. is like, it's moving into those cornfields in the Midwest. And I was in Illinois, the Chicago area, all the way from sort of elementary school, junior high school, college, and then directly in 1999, hopped on a one-way flight from Chicago to Silicon Valley, Bay Area.
Wow. So how did a Taiwan family end up in Chicago? Is that where did you go to the Cheers bar when you were younger? You go visit Sam Malone and Woody when you had on your free time?
It's an interesting question because in Silicon Valley there are so many entrepreneurs that are Taiwanese Americans.
Yeah.
So most of these global companies that were startups that started in Silicon Valley, you'd be surprised at the number that are actually Taiwanese Americans.
Yeah,
none of them came from San Francisco. Like we all were, and people were from Virginia, people were coming down from Louisiana, and then from Chicago. I think that it was pretty evenly divided in terms of where the opportunities were for families and their parents to be moving to in the US. But I think when their kids were growing up and as they started gravitating towards technology and entrepreneurship, whatever it is, there was a single location.
And then
so all of us
magneted over.
Yeah.
But did you have family? Was it because there was extended family in Chicago or something? Or?
It was just the immediate family. It was an opportunity that specifically my father decided to take. And I think he wanted to have that opportunity be also a window of opportunity, not for him, but also for the entire family, specifically for his kids.
Yeah, yeah. And what did your, what kind of family did you grow up in? What was it like, the dynamic? What did your father or what your parents do?
Well, I think I have to be thankful for them. They purchased a Apple II computer when I was pretty young, so they were open for their kids to experiment around with new technologies back at that time.
Are they tech people as well?
No, completely different. I think that even now, I don't think that they truly really understand what I was doing for the last 20 years in Silicon
okay.
Valley.
All right.
But I thought they were very hands-off, and I think that especially coming from more of an Asian background, that's I got to be grateful for that for my parents, right? And it was really, as long as it seemed like I was doing something productive, they let me have any sort of my choosing of the activities, of the time that I wanted to commit and spend on
the computer. They got you an Apple II to mess around with as a kid.
Yeah.
Wow,
yeah.
So that's pretty good from a Taiwan family, because we used to get pineapples. you guys know what I'm talking, it's a real thing. Did you know that?
I thought that was a joke. No.
No, it's a real thing. So, Jim, you didn't know this either.
I have no idea.
That's amazing. this is true. This is if you're old enough, then you'll know this. Back when computers were just about to come out, Apple was obviously leading a little bit in the personal computer side, and then the PC side was catching up.
Yes.
So the PC was either the IBMs or the clones.
Yes.
Right? The 286, right?
286,
or the AT or the XT. So there were the clones.
Yeah.
But some people at that time were making Apple clones as well. So you were able to go to the night market or some markets here, and you can get an Apple clone, and they were called pineapples. Seriously, so you had to be old enough to experience that. So you got the real deal. I had a pineapple for a little bit. Yeah. So we messed around with that. So were you a very hands-on tech kind of person right off the start?
It was always something that I enjoyed being able to, let's say, on a Sunday morning, being able to wake up and just having an idea in your head, but nothing tangible, and being able to sit there in front of just a keyboard and a monitor and a few hours, and being able to type a few things, but at the end of that day, that tangible item becomes something that's real, right? Yep. And in a way, I mean, I think that a lot of people think sort of engineering, programming, computer science is just another division within the engineering ecosystem. But I do think that there's something about being able to take this, whatever this idea is, and being able to really see it materialize over a period of hours or days or weeks, but just doing it from, you know, typing on a keyboard, and all of a sudden this thing that you had in your head is something that you can share, that you've created, and it works.
But in tech, I mean, you made one of the most amazing, you changed the landmark, the landscape for the world by creating this thing called YouTube at one point.
Yeah.
I know you've talked about the story a million times, but yeah, give us a quick version just so the audience can catch up how you started that.
So I moved to Silicon Valley, like I mentioned, in 1999. The reason that I moved out there, I was brought out there by the co-founder of PayPal. So I joined PayPal in 1999. And from 1999 to 2005 was the PayPal period. And if people know, there's a whole story about this PayPal mafia group. This includes Elon Musk, Peter Thiel, almost all the Reid Hoffman with LinkedIn. There are so many of these companies that have been started by that original crew from PayPal. And that period was a very great learning experience of what it took. We went through the dot-com crash just a few months after I arrived in Silicon Valley. And then there was things
so you caused the crash when you... Yeah. Oh, so you were there just prior to that. And then the world was turned upside down in Silicon Valley.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And I think there's definitely a period of drought when it came to investments, when it came to new startups, when it came to new resources coming to Silicon Valley. But PayPal was one of the few companies that managed to make it out of that period. But decisions had to be made instantaneously about what are the things that we're going to be doing, because what they had envisioned as the future trajectory of PayPal completely changed overnight.
Yeah.
And I think many of those lessons we were later able to reapply, not just with the founding of YouTube, but many of those companies that were started by groups in that PayPal mafia group. But I met the co-founder, who's Chad Hurley, the CEO, co-founder of YouTube, on the first day that I arrived in Silicon Valley in 1999. He was the graphics UI designer for all of PayPal, for all the features of PayPal.
Okay.
And so he was working with all the engineers, and we had collaborated very closely and grew tightly together as we started working on many of the features over that period of years. And in 2005, we had started talking about, this was after an acquisition by eBay, and this was after I think that we were able to do most of the things that we wanted to accomplish at PayPal. And so we started thinking about other projects, and this was a really ripe window period.
You guys wanted to...
So this was well-rehearsed as we started working with the PR agency, and we said, well, we were having a dinner party in my place in San Francisco, which I didn't have, and we were having dinner, we were having wine, and everybody was taking photos, they were taking videos. Next day, they share photos, but there was an option, there wasn't a product out there to share the videos. So therefore, we decided to come up with the option to share videos for people that were taking photos and videos. That dinner party never happened,
Really? Wow.
We were trained to do this. And then only years later, there was a billion-dollar lawsuit by Viacom that came in for a copyright violation with YouTube. And under oath, you can't tell the fictitious story anymore. You had to, and that was the first time the real true story about how YouTube came out.
Wow, this is so interesting. I've never,
It's an embarrassing story because that tells you. When we were first starting YouTube, this is still, April, May of 2005.
Yeah.
We were looking at all the dating sites out there that were just, but it was just photo dating. You hear, this is me, this is what I look like, this is my age, I'm looking for, but they were always photos. And so we thought, wow, there's gotta be something here. If you could just put videos instead of photos.
You're kidding.
So it was supposed to be this dating video site. We launched the service a week went by, zero videos were uploaded onto the service, and we changed our minds. We said, you know, before giving up, let's just open it up completely to any video. And we had to do little user interface changes. Instead of rating videos with hearts, you rated with stars, you know, little things here and there.
Okay.
But then, you know, well, the story kind of tells itself. YouTube started really accelerating growth, and people started sharing videos, and the virality of the videos kept, you know, blooming as more people came to YouTube, because somebody would share videos and they would find videos themselves that they wanted to share. So that it grew the number of creators. But I still don't think that people are using YouTube even today, 20 years later, for personals and dating.
You guys had to create your own stuff as well, right? To show people how it's, as you posted one of the first videos. Is that right?
Yeah, there were a lot of these, you know, test videos, because you just to be able to test out the service. Yeah. But I'm not known for my creative side, so I would take, you know, I'm known for a few things, but on YouTube, it was known for being the first uploader of a cat video on YouTube, and there's a huge fan base of cat videos. I was invited to give a talk in London by a group of global cat video creators that have these annual conferences to get together to talk about cat videos on the internet. And they invited me not because of the quality of the video that I created of my cat, but just because I was the creator of the first cat video on YouTube.
Yeah. So you see how technology connects people? Yeah. And that's interesting. So YouTube started with you guys trying to make a dating site, trying to get boys motivated enough and create something so that it makes it easier for them to meet girls. It's a way of mankind, I guess.
Yeah, maybe that's the advice to new founders. Is this a way to meet girls with the service?
And you're big on setting up and helping people, you know, newer, younger entrepreneurs as well. You have a very, very big presence here in Taiwan. You're doing a lot of very meaningful work, as I understand. We're going to get into that, but we're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.